Canadian art. What is it? It's exciting and dynamic, but can you name one Canadian artist? I mean, really, other than Emily Carr? When it comes to art, there isn't really any particular art that is considered Canadian. Rather than just make pretty art, artists want to use their art to bring awareness to the issues that we have to deal with in hopes of bringing about change, or even just to raise awareness of how much diversity there is in our world today. 100 years ago, the Group of Seven focused on painting landscapes that highlighted the stark beauty of Canada's wilderness. However, fast forward a century, and our landscape is not what it used to be. Unfortunately, the activities of humans have damaged our environment in countless ways. Edward Bertinsky uses amazing photographs to show the destruction of the landscape through mining in Ontario. He also explores how we have altered the land in our desire for oil in a series of photographs of the Alberta oil sands. Does anybody hear? The concern about the environment is enormous, especially for First Nations artists whose heritage lies within the land. For example, this artist makes huge, vivid paintings that merge elements of traditional First Nations art with modern art. Here he shows scientists trying to fix the hole in the ozone layer, and here how the land has been damaged due to clear-cut logging practices.
Take out people who've lived like this for 100,000 years. Inject a billion burgers worth of beef.
Some artists turn an eye to the future and how technology will affect urban planning and development. Eleanor Bond creates futuristic landscapes, which also keep in mind current conditions like climate change. In this piece, we can see how farmers kicked off the land might make a living in a modern world. Urban landscapes have also been a subject for artists of the Vancouver School of Photoconceptualism, which tackle issues surrounding living in an urban environment, such as racism, immigration, poverty, riots, class, and even just the changes in landscape. Starting in the 1950s, Fred Herzog took photos in Vancouver mainly of working class people and their neighborhoods. Here's an image of Granville Street from 1966 with the Hotel Vancouver in the background. Jeff Wall, best known of the photoconceptualists, has created a number of recognizable images of Vancouver, the landscape and the people, such as coastal motifs with the North Shore Mountains and The Thinker with the Vancouver skyline in the distance. A really interesting piece that is now in the new Woodward's development in Gastown is a 30 by 50 foot mural created by Stan Douglas of the Gastown riot in 1971. In addition to his large-scale Monument to East Vancouver, Ken Lum, a Chinese-Canadian artist, combines text with his photographic images to explore issues of race and class. Some artists use their art to explore the question of just what is art? While others want to protest things they disagree with in society, like the overconsumption of material goods and social inequalities. In the 1970s, the art collective Anything and Company, based out of Vancouver, made a button saying, "Art is all over," which meant that art can be anything, at any time, to anyone. artist Peter McFarlane makes art from things that have been thrown out while making a comment on our consumerist culture, which is obsessed with always acquiring new things. Like that new iPod your dad bought you. The artists of General Idea tackled the AIDS crisis in the 1980s and 90s. They made a hugely popular AIDS painting and sculpture, and they did a major art installation which brought awareness to the number of pills an AIDS patient needed to take just to survive. A really neat group of art activists, also based out of Vancouver, called Adbusters, used art to criticize capitalism and consumerism through the use of subvertisements, spoofing or making fun of popular advertisements. Throughout most of Canada's history, women have been largely absent in art. But today, female artists tackle issues such as how women are portrayed in art and media. One of the first feminist artists, Joyce Whelan, was very patriotic, and one of her famous paintings was actually a quilt, with the phrase "Reason over Passion" by former Prime Minister Pierre Trudeau stitched on it. She also made one of the first paintings of an interracial couple in 1963, which was actually pretty shocking for those days. Joanne Todd did a cool project that deals with the issues of identity and cultural power. She painted portraits of every Canadian soldier killed in Afghanistan. Each of the portraits was then installed as a part of a larger mosaic called O Canada, a Lament. Some would debate whether or not this is art, but in 1987, Jana Sterbak dealt with the issue of the female body and aging in a piece called Vanitas, Flesh Dress for an Albino Anorectic. This is a dress made entirely of meat. Sorry guys, Lady Gaga actually stole that one at the MTV Music Video Awards. I'm beautiful in my way, 'cause God makes no mistakes. I'm on the right track, baby, I was born this way. She photographs herself wearing it, and then she hung it to dry while it took on the appearance of an old, shriveled body. This piece challenges ideas about fashion and the idea that you are what you wear. As a member of the queer community of Vancouver, Tony Latour did a performance art piece called Queers on the Move, the Make Friends Project. At the end, they handed out mini cupcakes with pink icing and a small flag, which reminded people to make a friend today. I forget to pray for. Feminist and First Nations artist Rebecca Belmore has used unique and challenging ways to bring awareness to political and social injustices for both her people and for all women in Canada. With her performance piece Vigil and her video, The Named and the Unnamed, Belmore does a performance on the streets of Vancouver's downtown east side, which commemorates the large number of women who have gone missing from these streets. First Nations artists are creating some of the most original and exciting artwork in Canada today. Many of these artists combine traditional styles with modern materials and techniques to make statements about contemporary society and how the lives of First Nations people have changed since Canada was colonized. Sunny Asu creates clever works of art that uses pop culture to investigate social and historical events which have affected Aboriginal people. He created a series of cereal boxes with witty names such as Salmon Loops, Treaty Flakes, and Lucky Beads. These all look quite interesting, but the list of ingredients tells a different story and include things like lies, deception, and lack of government support. Brian Youngin has turned Nike shoes into Northwest Coast-style masks. golf bags into totem poles, plastic deck chairs into whale skeletons, and industrial waste bins into igloos. Michael Nickel Jagulanis uses traditional Haida stories and imagery with Japanese manga to create an innovative cross-cultural art style. He tells a dramatic Haida story in a 5-meter-long mural called Red. This video has provided you with just a glimpse of all the amazing art that is being produced right here in our own country.
Carry on and use it wisely.
And with respect, he passed it on to future generations. And man progressed.
So take a look around and look for that art. And then maybe make a little bit of it yourself. But remember, it's up to you to decide what art is going to be in the future. You can see me on the top, you can see me-